Today we will learn about neutral grounding. Grounding and earthing, words are synonymous, that means same, but in some parts people used to call as grounding, like in USA instead of earthing they call it as grounding, and if you take England, that is British people, they will call as earthing, and we sometimes we call as earthing, sometimes we call as neutral grounding. Grounding and earthing is same. What is meant by an earthing or grounding? The purpose of earthing is to safeguard against the dangers of shocks, fire, etc. So, to prevent the equipment as well as a person, we have to do the earthing for all the non-current carrying metallic parts. You take a motor, the motor body has to be grounded. You take electric iron, you take any current non-current carrying conductors, there has to be given a proper earthing. If proper earthing is not given, the poor earthing will give more dangerous than non-earthing. So, therefore, we have to give a good earthing. We all studied in second year and in final year, in earlier subjects, what is meant by an earthing, how a machinery or a person can be prevented from the shocks by connecting the earthing. Today, we will learn about the neutral grounding. So, that means all the machines, if you take a three phase machines, they will be connected either star connection or delta connection. When star connection is there, the fourth wire has to be neutral, that neutral has to be grounded. The purpose of neutral grounding is there, if any unbalances occurs in the machine, so unbalanced voltage or currents flowing in the circuit, and there is only one path to bypass these unbalanced currents through the neutral. If neutral is connected to the ground, so these unbalanced currents will flow into the ground through the neutral. If it is not grounded, then what are the effects? If it is not grounded, the voltage will be abnormally increases if a fault occurs. So, first of all, let us see where the earthing will be connected through this. Earthing should be connected to motor body, transformer tank, conduits of wiring, etc., support structures, towers, poles, etc., sheaths of cables, that is armored of the cables, body of portable equipments like iron, oven, etc. Now, by seeing these four points, so we are connecting the earthing to only metallic bodies, that is motor body, transformer tank, conduits, support structures, sheets of cables, body portable equipments like iron, oven, etc. So, these equipments has to be connected through the earthing. So, if earthing also, there are two types of earthings. One is isolated neutral, another is neutral grounded. So, what is meant by an isolated neutral? That means in a three phase machine, the neutral has to be left without giving any earthing connection. So, if we give without any earth connections, there are so many disadvantages. So, what are those disadvantages? Let us see through this diagram. This is isolated neutral, three phase generator, R phase, Y phase, B phase, and these three phase are connected to star. So, this point is called neutral. Now, the neutral is isolated. Isolated means the neutral is not grounded. Now, R phase is carrying a normal current of IR1, Y phase is carrying a current of IY1, B phase is carrying a current of IB1. So, when the generator is connected to the three transmission lines. Let us assume these R, Y, B are three transmission lines which are connected to the generator. And when their transmission lines are exposed in the atmosphere or weather, now generally they are laid over the overhead of the conductor, overhead of the towers. So there will be always capacitance effect from ground to line. Now you can see here, these are capacitances. So from R phase to ground, Y phase to ground, B phase to ground. So why this capacitance exists? Because it is exposed in the overhead. Therefore, from ground to lines, always there will be a capacitance exist. Since these lines are transposed, that means equalized, therefore the capacitance between all three phases, that is R phase, Y phase, B phase, will be same. And though the capacitance is distributed over along the line, but for theoretical purpose, let us assume the capacitance is concentrated at one place, that is CR, CY, CB. And once the capacitances are there, so through the capacitance always charging current flows. This is ICR, that means current flowing through the Y of the capacitor, current flowing through the B of the capacitors, ICR, ICY, ICB. Other than normal currents, always the capacitance currents also flows through the capacitance. So when the system is under normal condition, all the voltages, that is ER, EY, EB, they are spaced equally 120 degrees. The phase angle difference R phase, Y phase, B phase is 120 degrees. Similarly, the capacitance currents, they also have equal phase displacement 120 degrees, that is R to Y, Y to C, B, B to R, they have 120 degrees. But since they are pure capacitances, so they lead 90 degrees with respect to the phase voltages. That is R phase, and this is R phase current, they have phase displacement of 90 degrees. So during the normal conditions, this will exist. That means the magnitude of the voltage and currents, they are same. So when the fault exists on any one of the line, if the fault exists any one of the line means, so that means that particular phase will be dead. That means line to ground. Suppose R phase has short circuited, LJ fault has been occurred, that is line to ground. So R phase will collapse and other two phases will be healthy. They will be giving a normal supply to the load. Now let us see through the diagram. Before earth fault, R, Y, B, they have equal angle displacement, that is 120 degrees, and R to Y is called line voltage, and B to neutral, from neutral to phase is called the phase voltage. Now this is before earth fault, the phasor diagram stand as like this. Now after earth fault, that is B phase is grounded. Let us assume out of three phases, B phase is grounded. Once B phase is grounded, that means B is earthed. This is earthed. Now you can see here, this is R phase, Y phase, and B is grounded. Now neutral is separated from the earth. So earlier the neutral and earth are at the same potential, but here once the fault occurs on one phase, the neutral will be shifted from the ground. So let us see more details through the circuit diagram. If any one phase fault occurs, so how the circuit behaves. Now this is a three phase generator feeding to three transmission lines, that is R phase, Y phase, B phase. And assume there is a fault on the R phase, that means line to ground fault. When the line to ground fault occurs, then no capacitance current flows through the R phase because R is grounded. Now R is grounded. So now you will find the capacitive currents through the Y phase, that is IY2, through the B phase IB2. Only you will find capacitance current flows through the Y and B because these are healthy phases and this is grounded. Now once this situation occurs, then immediately in isolated neutral, the neutral point will be shifted from the ground. You can see with the phasor diagram. Now this is the earth potential. So now this R phase is on earth potential, that is grounded. Now once it is grounded, immediately the magnitude of the healthy phases will increase to root 3 times. This is voltage from B phase to E, that is earth. Similarly, voltage from Y to earth. So, there will be only in two phases voltage exists, that is B phase and Y phase, but the magnitude of the voltage will increase root 3 times than the normal value when the R phase is grounded. Now, what is the voltage across R phase? R phase is grounded, there is no voltage. So, but the magnitude of healthy phases will increase root 3 times. Now, you can see here, this is the neutral point. Neutral is shifted from the earth potential. Similarly, the capacitance current flows through the healthy phases, that is IY2, IB2. So, IY2 is this, this is IB2, and IC is the resultant of IB2 and IY2, that is phasor sum of IB2 and IY2 is the IC. So, this is looks like a parallelogram. So, when the R phase is grounded or by any one phase is grounded, the voltage of healthy phases will increase root 3 times. Similarly, the phase currents also increases to root 3 times. Once this is root 3 and this is root 3, then IC will become a 3. Now, parallelogram, if it is this 1, this is 1, then this will be root 3. If it is this is root 3, this is root 3, then this will be 3. So, IYT equal to IB2, IY2 equal to IB2 equal to root 3, and the resultant IC is 3 times. So, if the 3 times of the normal current flows through the winding, then normally it will damage the insulation of the windings. So, therefore, if isolated isolator neutral, that means neutral is not grounded, if it is isolated, if any fault occurs on one phase, that is phase to ground, the magnitude of the voltage of the healthy phases will increase to root 3 times. Similarly, the currents also, the capacitive currents also increases to root 3 times, but the resultant current will increase to 3 times. If 3 times of the currents will allow into the windings, it will damage the insulation. Not only damage the insulation, the fault will spread it to the other healthy equipments, that is associated equipment, and associated equipments also will be damaged. So, therefore, it is very much necessary to connect the neutral to the ground. And when the fault occurs, the fault current will be more, and when the fault current is more, the fault area will become ionized. So, once it is ionized, then even though the fault is clear, the area will become a conductive path and more arcing horns will be developed. Though fault is cleared, arcing horns will be developed. Why arcing horns will be developed? Because we are allowing more than the normal current, that is 3 times of the currents will be flowing into the fault. Therefore, the arcing horns will be developed. If these arcing horns or if these arcing earths are not removed immediately, then they will damage the entire system, and that not only that, if the fault is persists for more time, it will leads to second ground fault. If second ground fault is occurs, then immediately more and more current will be flowing and it will damage the complete equipment. So, therefore, it is highly necessary to connect the neutral to the grounding. So, let us see what are the disadvantages of the neutral grounding. Disadvantages of ungrounded neutral, that means neutral is not grounded. So, what are the disadvantages? We have studied through the circuit diagram. Let us see more points about this. If line to ground fault, arcing grounds established. As I said, if line to ground faults are there, so arcing grounds will be established. The voltage of two healthy lines increases by root 3 times. We have seen the phasor diagram. The voltage of two healthy lines increases by root 3 times. Capacitive currents also increased by root 3 times, causes stress on the insulation of all the machines. Earth faults cannot be easily sensed. So, why earth faults cannot be easily sensed? Once the fault occurs, there will be always the equipment be connected to the earth fault relay. If the more values are allowed into the earth fault relay, normally earth fault relay will malfunction, because it receives the more magnitude of the voltage as well as currents, therefore the relay will malfunction. That is it, earth faults cannot be easily sensed. Neutral point is shifted. We have seen through the phasor diagram, from the ground potential the neutral point is shifted. The duration of the arc, which may be 30 minutes, So the duration of the arc, if we allow the, so much time, then it will damage the equipment. Lightning surges do not find path to earth. Because neutral is not grounded, there is no path for the lightning surges. Therefore, lightning surges do not find path to earth. So by considering all these facts, it must be necessary to ground the neutral to earth so that we can minimize the fault or we can prevent the faults. So the groundings are so many methods. Let us see what are the types of groundings. Methods of groundings: 1. Solid grounding, 2. Resistance grounding, 3. Reactance grounding, 4. Arc suppression coil or Peterson coil grounding. There are two names: arc suppression coil or Peterson coil grounding, then voltage transformer grounding. So these are the various methods of grounding, but each has got its own advantages and disadvantages. But we can say solid grounding is earlier people were using for generator neutral earthing. After that, resistance grounding, just improved one, then reactance. Then nowadays, wherever you go, we will find for all the equipments are connected with a Peterson coil grounding, or it is also called arc suppression coil and voltage transformer grounding. So what are the advantages of grounding? The advantages of grounding, let us see through this. Advantages of neutral grounding: we have seen the disadvantages of isolated neutral grounding. Let us see advantages of neutral grounding. It is possible to eliminate arcing grounds. So when your neutral is connected to the grounding, it is possible to eliminate arcing grounds. The neutral point is not shifted. That means earth point and neutral point will be at same potential. So therefore, neutral point is not shifted. Voltages of the healthy phases remains harmless. We have seen in isolated grounding, the voltage of the healthy phase increases to root 3 times. But if it is grounded, then voltage of the healthy phases remains harmless. Earth fault relays can be installed because we are not allowing any extra magnitude of voltages or currents. Therefore, earth fault relays can be installed. They can function as it is. The life of insulation is long. So here also we are not allowing any extra voltages. Therefore, the life of insulation is long. The magnitude of the transient voltage is small. That means the voltage of the magnitude of the voltage will be very small. The induced static charges do not produce any disturbance. The induced static charges do not produce any disturbance as they are conducted to earth. Because the neutral is connected to earth, therefore, whatever the static charges, the capacitors will charge. So that charging charges do not produce any disturbance because they are conducted to earth, because we have connected to earth. But in earlier, it was not conducted to earth because it is not connected to earth. This system provides a reliable service. So this system provides very reliable service. Greater safety to personnel. Because we have grounded, it is greater safety to personnel and equipment, not only personnel, also for equipments, due to operation of relays and less maintenance. So these are the various advantages of neutral grounding. That is, arcing harms can be suppressed, neutral is not shifted from the ground potential, and the healthy phases, magnitude of the healthy phases voltage will be as it is. So we can conduct static charges of the voltage will be conducted to the ground, and there is a provision for the, if lightning surges occurs, then there is a provision to discharge the voltage to the ground. So therefore, we have to ground the neutral. So there are various methods as we discuss, that is solid grounding, resistance grounding, reactance grounding and Peterson coil grounding. Let us see one by one in detail. So solid grounding. In solid grounding, let us see through this diagram. This is a generator having a three phases R, Y, B connected to three transmission lines, R phase, Y phase, B phase. And generator, generally it is connected to the neutral because we have to take the three phase and neutral supply. So it is possible to take three phase as well as single phase supply if it is connected in star fashion. So now this is a star point. it is a neutral. The neutral is connected to ground. This is a ground. So it is connected through a small wire, but negligible resistance. No resistance is there. It is connected through a negligible resistance wire, and normal currents are IR, IY, IB. And you can see here, when the normal current flows, then normal capacitive currents will be there for R phase, Y phase, and B phase. And when normal currents are flowing in the lines, then the voltage and currents, they will have a phase displacement of 120 degrees each other. And again, from voltage to current, the phase displacement will be 30 degrees. But voltage to voltage of one phase to another phase, they have a 120 degrees phase displacement. And let us assume the B phase has been grounded. Now, out of three phase R, Y, B, the B phase has been grounded. There LG fault occurs on one of the line, that is on B phase. So if ground fault occurs, let us see how the circuit will be. Now in B phase, no capacitive current will be flowing because B is grounded, and you will find the capacitive currents only in R phase, that is IR, and Y phase, that is IY, IR and IY. Now see through the diagrams, phasor diagram. So this is IR, this is IY. So two capacitive currents, IR and IY, and this is VRE, voltage of from R to E. This will become a line voltage now. Now always the phase capacitive current will be 90 degrees with respect to the voltages. So from VR to IR, the phase displacement will be 90 degrees, and the resultant current is IR to IY, is the resultant current is IC, which is flowing to the ground, and the IC is the phasor sum of IR and IY. Now when the B is at fault, then the fault current IF is flowing into the ground, and this fault current flows to the ground, also try to flows through the neutral to the source, that is to the equipment, again back to the ground. So that means the current is enter into the equipment of the windings, again come back, again flows into the ground. So now let us see here what happens through the phasor diagram. The resultant capacitive current is IC, this, and the fault current is this. These two currents are anti-phase to each other. That means they will have a phase displacement of 180 degrees and anti-phase. Therefore, this direction is IC is this side and IF is this side. Therefore, this charging current or capacitive current will be neutralized by this fault current. Once the capacitive current is neutralized by the fault current, that means there is a capacitive current is neutralized. Therefore, no arcing horns will be developed. So in solid grounding, if one phase grounded, so this fault current will be flowing anti direction of this IC. Therefore, this IC will be neutralized by IF, and no IC will be existing. Once there is a no IC, that is capacitive current, so arcing horns will be will not be produced. Now here the neutral and earth also not shifted, both are at same potential, they are at zero potential. So now B phase is at zero potential, that means on earth, neutral also not shifted. So in solid grounding, if you do the solid grounding, that means no arcing horns will be produced, and the voltage of the healthy phase, magnitude of the voltage on healthy phases will not increase. Therefore, the currents also, magnitude of the currents also will not increase. The resultant current of the healthy phases is IC. This IC will be neutralized by the fault current. So once the IC is neutralized, therefore no arcing horns will be developed, and there is a no insulation problems. If arcing horns are arcing earthings are developed, therefore there is a insulation problem. Now in this, there is a no insulation problem, and there is a no high values of voltages or currents flowing in the windings. The windings also will not be damaged. But one thing you will find in this, if the fault current is allowed into this windings, so therefore the winding insulation will damage. Therefore this solid grounding has to be used where high impedance circuits are required. Generally the impedance of the circuit will be very less. When the fault current is will be generally more, If this more fault current is allowed into the windings, the windings insulation will damage and it leads to a short circuit. Therefore, this method has to be solid grounding method has to be used where high impedance circuits are required. Let us see some more points about the solid grounding. Disadvantage of solid grounding. High fault current flows into the equipment. High fault current flows because through the negligible resistance we have connected, therefore high fault current flows into the equipment. System becomes unstable. When the fault current is allowed into the machine, what happens? System becomes unstable. System employed where circuit impedance is high. As I told, if circuit impedance is less, then the fault current will be flowing into the machine itself. Therefore, they damage the windings. Therefore, it is used where circuit impedance is high. Difficult to handle the circuit breakers. It is very difficult to handle the circuit breakers because the fault current is allowed into the machine means it has to flow only through the circuit breaker. So, therefore, heavy contacts are used. Frequently, the contacts will be burnt because it more fault current will be flowing through the contact. Therefore, heavy contacts are required. So, beyond 33 kV is uneconomical. So, the system is used only less than 33 kV. Beyond 33 kV is uneconomical. These are the disadvantages of solid grounding. But what is the advantage? Advantage is the magnitude of the healthy phases will not increase. Once the magnitude is not increased, we are not allowing the higher values. Once we are not allowing the higher values, then arcing earthings or arcing grounds are neutralized. That is the advantage of solid grounding. So, let us see the next method, resistance grounding. This is a resistance grounding. That means all three windings connected in star connected through a resistance. The resistance may be a 1 or the resistance may be a more than 1. So, the resistance once you are connected, now again assume that there is a fault on B phase, the fault current flowing into the ground and the resultant capacitive current, that is IR and IY, is IC. Now, these two currents, how they flow into the ground, let us see through this phasor diagram. Now, this is the phasor diagram on earth potential. This is the R phase VRE and this is the VYE and IY, IR is the capacitive currents and IC is the resultant. The phasor sum of IR and IY is the IC. So, here the fault current, when the resistance is connected to the ground, the fault current will be divided into two components, that is IF1, which is again divided into IF2. And these two currents, one is lagging with 90 degrees with respect to the faulty phase, another is in phase with respect to the phase voltage. The lagging component IF1 is anti-phase with the IC, therefore the IC will be neutralized by the IF1. So, once this IC is neutralized by the IF1, then that means here also arcing grounds are neutralized because IC is neutralized by this IF1. And here neutral is not shifted from the ground. So, here the advantage of having the resistance is by varying the resistance can be varied in the taps. So, once it is varied, so the fault current will be adjusted because I equal to V by R, IF equal to V by R. So, I is inversely proportional to resistance. Once the resistance varies, then definitely we can control the fault current. So, once we can adjust the fault current will be adjusted by the IC. Therefore, the IC will be neutralized. That is the advantage of having a resistance connected to the neutral. Resistance grounding. That means the ground resistance should be grounded through the neutral. So, the advantage of resistance grounding is here arcing grounds are eliminated and the fault IC, that means charging current or capacitive current neutralized by the fault current. By adjusting the tappings of the resistance, we can vary the fault current. That is the advantage we have in resistance grounding. But the disadvantages are, let us see, in resistance grounding, resistance is introduced in the neutral grounding. More advantages over solid grounding, that is minimizes fault current. Arcing grounds are eliminated. System is costlier because we have to purchase the resistance, that coils are very costly. So, therefore, system is costlier. But the more disadvantage is power loss takes place because resistance is there, there will be always I square R loss. So this loss has to be compensated. So these are the disadvantages. System is costlier, power loss takes place. But advantages are arcing grounds are eliminated. Let us see about the reactance grounding. So in reactance grounding, generally this is a resistance grounding. In place of resistance, the reactance will be connected. The reactance will be variable reactance. So here the reactance will be, instead of resistance, now reactance is connected. This is the coil. The reactance, again it can be varied to vary the fault current, to adjust the fault current. So you know I equal to V by X. So once X is reactance of the coil, so once the reactance of the coil is varied, definitely the fault current also varies, because IF equal to inversely proportional to 1 by X. If X is varied, then definitely fault current can be adjusted. So but the advantage is, earlier in a resistance there will be a power loss, but here reactance is there, there is no power loss in this. That is the advantage of reactance grounding compared to resistance grounding. So some points about the resistance let us see realized pictures how the neutral and resistance grounding will be connected in a substations. Now these are the three phase lines R, Y, B. Let us assume maybe a three phase transformer, and the small point is the neutral, R, Y, B and neutral. Neutral is connected through this green line, connected to the resistor. This is resistance grounding. So this box, red box, is the resistance coil. This is a box of resistance, and from the resistance it is connected to the ground. That means the neutral is connected through the resistance to the ground. So in this way the equipment will be connected in your substations or in generators. So this is the solid grounding. The below one is solid grounding. Again here the neutral is connected through the green wire directly to the ground. So here there is no resistance. Here you can see there is a box of resistance. Therefore this is called resistance grounding. Here it is a solid grounding. Only wire is connected without having any resistance. These are the examples for resistance grounding and solid grounding. So we have seen about the resistance grounding and reactance grounding as well as solid grounding. But nowadays mostly all the equipments are connected through the arc suppression coil or Peterson coil. So by having a arc suppression coil or Peterson coil, we have some advantages compared to solid grounding, resistance grounding, reactance grounding. What are the advantages? If any one phase faulted, but the other two phases also start giving the supply to the load. But in earlier grounding methods, if one phase goes out of order, that is fault occurs, other two phases also will not supply the voltage to the load. But here if one phase goes out of order, but other two healthy phase also start giving the supply as a two phase system. That is the advantage we have. And in Peterson coil, lot of tapping adjustments will be there. By adjusting the tappings, we can adjust the reactance. Once we adjust the reactance, then the fault current will be adjusted. Let us see about the Peterson coil grounding with this diagram. Now three phase connected to the neutral, that is in star. Again the star point is connected through the Peterson coil. This is a Peterson coil having tappings. These dots are tappings. And assume there is a fault on B phase. If the fault occurs on B phase, normally fault current flows through the ground and it will be adjusted by this coil, so that the fault current never allowed into the equipment as like a solid grounding. Now the IR and IY is the capacitive currents flowing from the R phase to the ground and Y phase to the ground, IR and IY. So through this phasor diagram, this IR and IY, and these are 90 degrees with respect to their phase voltages, and this IR and IY resultant is IC. So the resultant current IC will be anti direction of the fault current. So now this is the IC, this is the IF. So this IC can be adjusted by this IF. So once IC is adjusted by IF, again the arcing grounds are minimized, and here also the neutral is not shifted, and the magnitude of the voltage has not increased. So you can see here the voltage of the magnitude is VRE, the voltage of the magnitude is V by E. So now the fault occurs, this fault current flowing anti-direction of the IC, therefore the IC will be neutralized by the IF, and for this tappings can be adjusted. So let us see some points about the Peterson coil grounding. Peterson coil earthing, iron cored reactor connected in the neutral earthing. So the Peterson coil is nothing but a cored reactor, iron cored reactor connected in the neutral earthing, provided with a number of tappings. It is provided with number of tappings. If earth fault on one phase, other healthy phase are kept in operation. That is the advantage of Peterson coil. If one phase is faulted, the other healthy phase are kept in operation. Arcing faults are self-extinguished because by adjusting the tappings, of the Peterson coil, we can minimize the fault current, and this fault current in turn neutralize the charging current, capacitive current. Therefore, the arcing currents are self-extinguished. The arcing faults are self-extinguished, and appropriate tapping being used for each change reduce the fault current to a low value by adjusting the tapping. This is the main advantage. Reduce the fault current to a low value by adjusting the tappings. Used in transmission lines, and L equal to 1 by 3 W square C. So here what happens, the Peterson coil has to be connected to the capacitor to equalize the capacitance at resonance condition. At resonance, what happened? The XL equal to XC. When XL equal to XC, the XC equal to 3 times of IC, 3 times of the current will be produced. So therefore, IL equal to 3IC. So if we solve it, then we will find L equal to 1 by 3 W square C. By C varies time to time. By adjusting the C, L can be adjusted, or by varying the L, C can be adjusted. Coils are immersed in the oil for self-cooling. Coils are, because once a coil, current flows through the coils, lot of heat effect will be there. Therefore, coils are immersed in the oil for self-cooling. So, if the fault occurs, the fault will be adjusted by the tappings of the Peterson coil. But sometimes, if the fault persists more time, then it leads to the second ground fault. If second ground fault is allowed, so more values of the currents will be flowing in the windings. It will damage the insulation. Not only damage the insulation, this fault current will flow through the associated equipment, and associated equipments also will be damaged. So for that, the latest one is through the Peterson coil, it will have like this. So this is a, let us say, generator RYB neutral. This neutral is connected through the circuit breaker and high resistance to the ground, and this is the Peterson coil having the different tappings, and this is the current secondary transformer CT connections connected to the relay contacts, and in turn relay contacts are connected to the battery coil through the trip coil system, and the trip coil will be interlocked with the circuit breaker handle. So if the fault occurs on any one phase, let us say the fault occurs on R phase, so this is the fault. Once the fault occurs on R phase, so high fault current will be flowing. So high fault current flowing through the CT. So the fault current flows through the CT of the secondary terminal. When the high magnitude of the currents flows through the CT, therefore here the magnetic force will be developed, and due to that magnetic force, this lever will be, relay contacts will be closed. That means this contacts will be closed. Once this contacts is closed, that means this will be pulled like this. So this is closed. So once this is closed, what happens? Now the battery circuit is closed now. So now let us see this. So once the battery circuit is closed, then the current will flow through the battery. This is the current, and the trip coil will energize. Once the trip coil is energized, and the trip coil will pull this circuit breaker handle, therefore the circuit breaker also closed. Once the circuit breaker closes, then the high magnitude of the fault current rushes through the resistance to the ground to save the Peterson coil. During the normal operation, the Peterson coil will be operated. When the second fault, ground fault occurs, the high magnitude of the fault current will be diverted from the Peterson coil to the circuit breaker through the resistance to the ground. So in all the modern systems, we have only in this type of connection. That is, whenever the fault occur, the fault current will be diverted to the ground through the high resistance. So these are the various methods of the groundings. We have discussed about the solid grounding, neutral grounding, solid grounding, resistance grounding, reactance grounding, Peterson coil grounding. And this grounding will be connected in all the substations and as well as for all the equipments. If we go back to the substations, not there are so many equipments like generators, transformers, towers, lines, and CTPT sets, relay sets, etc. So all these equipments also has to be grounded. So therefore, generally they will do the mat grounding, mat or mesh grounding. What is meant by mat or mesh grounding? You know what is meant by mat? Mat can be spread on the floor. So like that, all the conductors, earth conductors will be spreaded like a mat. Let us see how the grounding will be done in a substation through this diagram. Now this is the mat. All is also called mesh or mat grounding. Now these are the earth conductors. The earth conductors may be copper, aluminium, or galvanized strips. Let us say this is a mat grounding.
Hello.
Now this is a tower. Yes.
Question and.
Yes.
What are the advantages of resistance grounding over solid grounding?
The advantages. Your question is, what are the advantages of resistance grounding or solid grounding? The advantages of resistance grounding or solid grounding is, here by adjusting the resistance, we can adjust the fault current. That is the advantage we have, and we are not allowing any fault current into the equipment. Now let us see this diagram. This is a tower. Tower is grounded to this mat, and this is a CTPT set grounded. This is another equipment is grounded. This is a transformer grounded, isolator grounded. So all these connections has to be grounded. Finally, it is connected to the mat, and this mat is again connected to earthing. So let us see what is meant by an earthing. We have seen in second year this earthing. This is a pipe earthing. This is a pipe. It is connected to the funnel, and this is the conductor. This earth conductor has to be connected to the equipment. This should be connected to the equipment. And this pipe, generally you will have a 1.25 plus 2.5, 3.75 meters of the depth. We have to dig the trench, and over in that we have to put the pipe. Then fill up with the charcoal and salt, alternate layers of charcoal, salt, and sand. Then you construct a masonry, brick masonry. This is a brick masonry. So here there is a CA hinged cover will be there. By opening the cover, then you can put the water in this. So this is the way of doing the earthing. This already we have studied in second year as well as in earlier class also. So the grounding, main purpose of grounding is to keep the earth at zero potential. But if it is not possible, at least keep the earth potential at least as 1 or 2 ohms. All the substations, all the earth pits, they have to be maintained at low resistance values. The maximum value will be allowed as per IS standards is less than 3 ohms. But for big power stations, it is allowed only 1 ohm. So how you will maintain 1 ohm? That means you have to insert the GI pipe by digging a 3.5 meters depth hole. And surrounding the pipe, you have to put the coal and charcoal, salt, because they are very good conductors. And you have to put the water so that there will be chemical reaction takes place, and they maintain the ground potential at zero. So these are the various methods of doing the grounding. And let us have a more discussion in the next class.